Good morning. Welcome to West Heights. I'm Pastor Jacob. It is wonderful to have you all with us here today, both in person and online. If you're joining us online, if you would take a moment to let us know you are here. And if you're here, the ushers will be coming forward to pass the attendance pads. We invite you to fill those out completely. A lot of times, if we send out an email and we don't get something correct, we'll go back to there, especially if something gets kicked back, or if we make that phone call and it goes beep-doo-deep, that number is out of commission. Especially as many of those landline numbers, we forget that we have changed even if we got rid of the landline 12, 15 years ago. I actually found it on one of the accounts that I had at AT&T when we came back to Kansas. They're like, oh, you mean this number? I was like, I haven't had that number since I was 20. So, got a couple of great things I want to highlight, especially about Holy Week, as I was shocked to realize that it is this month. So I want to just bring those around to you. We have Palm Sunday, we have our Palm Parade, and then we're also doing our mural reveal. Say that three times quick. So the Pride mural that took place of the doors, and the doors, if you didn't know, were starting to rot. Two of the doors are starting to rot out, and so we had to take them down for safety's sake, and so we put up another blank canvas, and it's almost done. It's got a few more pieces, but we will reveal that on the 24th after worship. We'll invite us all to go over there. We'll reveal it, and then we're going to invite you all to help us paint the backside. We'll have very specific instructions, so you don't have to be artistic. You just have to be willing, okay? So that'll be a great little part where all of your hands will help to make the other design. So, and then we have Good Friday, right? Good Friday, may or may not have a slide, I don't remember. So Good Friday, we are doing the service from the beginning, so we'll start it from Thursday night. So if you're thinking about Thursday night through Sunday morning, we're gonna start Good Friday on Thursday night with Jesus and his disciples at the communion table. Because to me, the connection from communion table to the cross is a pretty strong one. And so we will start that at 7 o'clock. We'll start with communion. We will join Jesus in that celebration of grace and hope and love. And then we will move towards the story of the crucifixion. And then as we do that, the lighting will get darker and darker, and it'll end with this somber note. And then 3 days later, Jesus isn't dead anymore. He rose. And so then we'll celebrate on Easter specifically, in case you didn't get that part. But specifically, I feel it's a little weird sometimes when we don't pay attention to the death of Christ before we jump into the resurrection. All right? Because we all like the idea of being remade, or many of us do. But the idea that you can be remade without having to do some pre-work is kind of a little silly. We hope you can join us for that Good Friday service. And then we are having our Easter egg hunt directly after our Easter service. So we invite you to join us for that. Should have a great time. And we're going to do the egg hunt inside so that no matter what nature decides to do to us, as it is the last day in March, right, I think? So we all know that could be 8 degrees or 80 degrees, and it could be snow or a tornado. And it could be the one day it's nice that whole week, right? And we've prepped for the worst, and then we have the most beautiful thing outside. So either way, we'll be doing great ministry on Easter. And we've already worked through some really fun stuff on how we're going to envelop and live out that resurrection feeling in worship. So we can't wait to share that with you all. There's a lot of great stuff coming up. And we invite you to stand and join in our opening hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, number 400.
Thank you. and I will be your reader today. Please join me in our call to worship. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Our first reading comes from Matthew 18, verses 21 through 22. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if my brother or sister sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. As we move into our time of prayer, I just want to invite you all, if you didn't have a chance to make it to one of our Wednesday services, there are two of our infographics that we had for the last 2 weeks out on the entryway next to the bulletins. There's the mindfulness for beginners and the focusing instruction books or instruction infographics. So if you haven't had a chance to grab one of these, I invite you to do that, especially as they'll kind of be hitting on the connection and that tie-in when we talk during today's sermon. In a perfect world, or as we keep going, my intent is to create a like 6-week curriculum where we'll do a 6-week class on prayer, meditation, and contemplation. Contemplative prayer is inherent in how the early church was formed, and yet in our tradition, we don't spend a whole lot of time doing it corporately. We do invite people to do it by themselves, and so I'm going to be working on that as we put it together, so that hopefully sometime in the fall we can have a class for that for anyone who missed or was interested in kind of diving a little deeper. So I invite you, in this spirit of peace and grace, to take a couple of deep breaths, and as those thoughts pop up about the grocery list or what's happened this week, just allow them to pass through with a sense of gratitude for those reminders as they come. And then after a few breaths, I'll lead us in the pastoral prayer, and the Lord's Prayer will be on the screen for you. Will you pray with me? Good morning, God. We gather together on this absolutely beautiful spring day in praise and thanksgiving of those reminders that even in the midst of the winter, there is new life and new possibility. Today, God, as we look towards communion, as we look towards this moment of sharing together in the meal that Christ offered to us, and sharing together in that grace and that hope, that forgiveness, we'd ask that you would help us to let go of those burdens that we carry, many of which we have worked our way through, and yet we bear the shame or carry with us the guilt because somewhere deep inside, we don't know if we're worth it. And so, God, we would help, we look to you to remind one another that we are beloved children of God. Because as we remember this, it moves throughout our everyday. Whether we're working with those who work for us, whether we're volunteering with others, or sitting at home making a phone call to a friend. Help us to anchor in the fact that you, O God, love us above and beyond anything we could imagine. And in doing so, invite us to love others with that same blanket grace that knows no end. And so, God, we have shared some of the verses from the Psalms, words of forgiveness and hope. And we'd ask that you would help us to lay down those fears, those brokenness, those shame and guilt. It is in your Son, Jesus' holy name, that we pray, and we share together the words that he taught us so many years ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. If you would join me in our prayer hymn.
Our second reading comes from Matthew 18, 23 through 35. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, the Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children, and all his possessions, and payments to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, Pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, Have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, You wicked slave! I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Would the children come forward for our kids' message? Hello, how's everybody doing? I have a favorite sport. You could probably guess what it is. What?
Basketball.
Anybody else here think basketball is their favorite sport? Who? Right there? Yeah, I bet you could beat me. Well, I'll tell you, I'm no Caitlin Clark or Michael Jordan, but we're going to try something out today with our kids' message, okay? All right. So here's what I need you all to do, okay? I need you all to kind of stand in a line facing this direction. Okay? Kind of right there in front of the stage or on the step, either way. Okay? And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to have Danny hand you each one of these. And if we don't have 10 kids up here, just remove ones that don't have stars on them. Okay? Okay. I didn't stretch beforehand, but we're going to try this out. Any other basketball fans out there? Yeah? It's not a breach of the book of discipline if I set some of these paper balls up here, is it? No? If it is, just send an email to jacobcloud at... No, I'm just kidding. All right, here's what we're going to do. Okay, and you all, feel free to cheer for me, okay? Every athlete does best when there's... a crowd behind them, you know, cheering them on, okay? You two back there, choir, okay? Four-part harmony when you cheer for me, though, okay? All right, so here's what I'm going to do. When I stand behind you, okay, I want you to, I'm going to shoot, and you're going to open up your poster, okay? You're just going to open up your poster for everybody to see. Cameras, we might need to, you know, focus a little bit because they might be kind of hard to read, but I try to make them as bold as possible. And I'm going to shoot, okay? We ready? You ready? All right, here we go. Oh. Can you show that to everybody for me? Go for it. Okay. All right. I'm not going to give up. Here we go. I'm just going to get a little closer. All right. Okay. Here we go. Hey, thank you. Oh. What you got for me? Okay. Gabby, I won't give up. I'm going to keep going. All right. All right. Here we go. You ready for this? Okay. All right, what we got here? What's it say? Hang in there. I will. I will. Thank you. I appreciate your encouragement. All right, you ready? It's your turn. It's my turn, too. You think I'm going to make it this time? You do? Okay. Oh. What's it say? Go and show everybody. $5 says he misses again. Are we gambling in church today? Is that what this is? No, I'm just kidding. All right, here we go again. This is all. You think it's going in this time? Yeah, I bet you'd make it better than I would. I hit the back. I tapped the backboard that time. I'm getting closer. What's it say? Try again. Okay. I will. You all are so encouraging. If I was a coach, I would have, like, cut me by now or traded me. Okay. We ready? All right. Are you cheering for me? Thank you. Okay. I feel like I should stretch a little bit first. I need Gatorade. Anybody got Gatorade? No? What's it say? So frustrating. God help him, please. Yes. All right. All right. Last one.
You ready? Yay! Yeah? Yeah! High five. All right. Hey, kids, you all did such a great job. Let me talk with you all about that real quick, okay? Did I make every shot?
No.
No. You know, when I think about my basketball skills and life, I realize I don't make every shot that I take. When it comes to life, we don't always do things right, do we? Sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes the Bible calls those things sin. Sometimes we don't mean it. Sometimes mistakes, you know, we just can't do the right thing. We don't know what the right thing is to do. And sometimes when we do the wrong thing, we feel really bad about it. We feel guilty and we feel ashamed. And to an extent, just to a certain point, that's okay. Because it's okay to feel bad about the wrong things that we've done because they hurt us and they hurt other people. And it's not what God would want us to do. But sometimes, especially for people like me, I feel really bad about things that I do for a long time. And what the Bible says, it calls that is guilt and shame. And those are things that hold us back. It's like I'm never going to get closer to the thing that I want to do because I'm always holding myself back here with guilt and shame. And I just want to tell you all today, it's okay to fail forward, okay? And what I mean by that is that when you do the wrong thing, learn from the wrong thing, apologize, make it right, but then keep going. Don't give up. The way that you all were cheering for me with my paper, it encouraged me to continue. I believe that God loves us so much that even when we do the wrong thing, he doesn't hate us for it. As a matter of fact, he actually cheers us on and says, keep going. You're almost there. You can do it. And things like, I love you. Amen? Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right, let's pray. This is a repeat after me prayer. God, thank you so much for your love. Your love that calls us to come forward to you. To come closer to you. Even when we don't do the right thing. You still cheer us on. Thank you so much for your love.
Thank you so much for your love.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks, kids. Yes, thank you.
That was really cool. There was one sign that you all didn't get to see that said, do you play for the Shockers? I thought it was pretty funny. So, and then I was like, no, that was shooting like that. It's got to be K-State basketball. Just kidding. Jason in the back, come on! No, I enjoy basketball. I'd rather play soccer if I get a chance. But at least basketball doesn't put me to sleep like baseball does. So, it keeps on going. I say that like I haven't fallen asleep at 10 o'clock and so many KU basketball games that I woke up going, did we win? First thing I do, pull your phone over, go, okay, whew, we made it. So, will you pray with me? Gracious God, as we come before you in this time, we seek your wisdom, your grace, your love. Help us to understand the passages before us so that we might know your call upon our lives. It is in your Son Jesus' holy name that we pray. Amen. So today we're talking about letting go. And too often, what happens in our society and in many of us is that we remember our mistakes long after everyone else has forgotten them. The only exception is if you're the oldest, you get to complain about how your younger siblings got away with everything, and some of those that get to continue long after. But for the most part, we remember our own mistakes, our own failings, a lot longer than everybody else does. In fact, have you ever had one of those moments where you were sure that you offended somebody, and so you thought about it, and you worked on it, and you waited until the next chance you got to talk to them, and then you apologized, and they went, huh? I don't even remember that. And some of us are just being nice, right? They're trying to be nice, which confuses people on the spectrum like myself, because I'm going, wait, but I did say something, right? And other times, it's just that we've gone, you know, that was a little awkward, or that wasn't an instance that I wouldn't prefer. But I know that this person, I know that Jacob cares. I know this person in front of me cares. I know my child cares. My grandma cares. Mistakes and having, a little bit of a short temper happen to all of us at some point. But there are those moments that we hold on to as though God would expect us to carry it around. We imagine it, or it sits with us like a fold in your sock that you get after you put on your boots and you can't change your socks for like 3 hours. Huh? Or if you've ever had, here's another sock one, where the stitch line gets on the top of your little toe. And every time you wiggle it, it moves around a little bit and then comes right back to the worst spot. Am I resonating with some of you? Okay, for those of you who are going, that's never a problem, you're a lucky person. Okay? And clearly they made socks for people like you. If I have too many strings on the inside of my socks, I'm like, this one's going in the trash. Well, we each have those different moments of things that stick with us. They agitate us, they irritate us. And a lot of times when we don't process them, we end up sitting in this spot where our worst moments are the ones we spend the most time thinking about. The things we wish we could have done better, and here's where we go with a lot of times. I've learned now that what I did back then wasn't okay. And so then we just, if I had a TARDIS, if I had a time machine, if I could go back and fix the things I messed up, then this person wouldn't be hurt. Then I wouldn't have stumbled over that thing. I might not have had that person leave the church or fill in the blank for a friend who just kind of faded away. And so we ruminate on these things. They stay with us. Even if the person that we did them to or near has let it go years before. So I love this passage, this honest moment as Peter is going, all right, Jesus, so how many times do I need to forgive my neighbor? And I like Peter because he's very particular and he doesn't seem to get most things the first time, which really feels like close to my heart. Because there's definitely that time where you get it right the first time and you're like, yeah. But most of the time for me, it's like third, fourth, fifth time. And if someone else tells me the way it will work, I have to fail at my way 3 or 4 times before I try theirs. Stubbornness isn't always the best way, but it is a way of my people. And I say my people because my children have inherited at least a single dose of stubbornness. And I feel bad for my lovely spouse who gets to deal with that on many occasions. But we hold on to some of these things like they're stones we're putting in a backpack. And one of my favorite moments of working with high school students, I was a camp counselor for years, and I 1 year was the spiritual life coordinator for the campus Institute, which is one of the longest running United Methodist day camps for high schoolers. And so the very beginning, we had this conversation around sin and the things we bear. And so I literally made them take rocks and put them in the bags that they carried around. Some of these rocks might have weighed 2-3 pounds, okay? Like this big. I did have a couple that were larger, but I put them intentionally at the bottom of the pile so that it would just be me hauling them around to the next place. Well, we get to this, and you'd be amazed at how much complaining can happen from one person at age 13 to 18 who has to carry 2 pounds. It's quite a bit. And when 3 or 4 of them get together, the chorus of their song of hard knock life seemed to be, you know, all, everywhere we went. But Wednesday of that camp, we were in worship, and the whole point was to lay down our burdens. And so as they came forward, they had been intentionally carrying this, and I made sure to do it the evening service so they couldn't have the freedom of not having it in the morning. And so we get into this evening service, and they take out their rocks, some of which they have decorated prettily, right? There were paint markers at camp, and so some people wrote on there. Some people wrote their burdens. Other people wrote, like, this was a bad idea, Jacob. And so we talked about laying down our actual burdens before God. So we invited the students to take that time and focus upon that rock as an image for them, as a symbol of their own brokenness, of not as an anger that God has towards anyone, but as the part that we knowingly carry around. Because the ironic thing about these students that none of them got was they could have just left the rock right there. I didn't force anybody to do anything, although I did enjoy their complaints. Because it made for really good, I'm still using sermon illustrations now, and it's been like 10 years, 12 years. And so we get into the space, they put them down, and we stacked them until they came about this high. And as those stones were put around that, where the burdens were laid, that stone tower, do you know what it was called? What's that? A cairn, it's an Ebenezer. Here I raise mine Ebenezer. We just sang the line. That's what an Ebenezer is. It's a place of memory. And so the Jews would, when they went around, God would tell them to make a marker or set up an altar. And when they would do that, they would intentionally leave stones piled in such a specific way that everyone, when they came back to that spot, would remember, oh, that was when we worshiped, or that was when we had that great time of celebration with one another. And I remember those great deeds that God did in this spot. And so here we were at camp, and they laid their stones down. We built this Ebenezer. And for the next 4 days at worship, it reminded us. It reminded us to lay down our own suffering. Not because, you know, experiencing shame or frustration is an evil thing, but because too often, like I said, it becomes what we focus so much of our heart and our souls on that we miss the intent of freedom from death and sorrow and brokenness. I walked out of frame, don't worry. And it's really beautiful to set it aside, to set those things down. And when you take it off of your back, because most of our students had a backpack or they had the string bags, you know. I know they still have them around, but it's not as often. You remember for a while, it was like they're across every college campus. And then high school, you know. Right now, I'm seeing people with actual backpacks in school again. So that's nice. So as we come into this moment, we see, and I want us to be of this intentionality. And it's one of the reasons that I pointed this out was that if you're struggling to process stuff, if you're still sitting with a lot of this, then I highly recommend you take a look at the focusing one, and you let that be a guide or an opportunity for you to focus upon that area that you just can't seem to get rid of. You know, doing this a few times invites God to heal into those spaces, invites you to let go, invites you to make your own literal or perhaps just a symbolic Ebenezer. But you see, Jesus, when he gets this story, he doesn't just stop with the, basically, Peter, you need to forgive so often that you don't remember how many you've counted to. And then he goes, and it's similar to this. And I'm just going to switch it all. We're going to go all the way through. I'm going to jump through a chunk right here because we have communion today, and I don't want to miss that. I want us to get into that space. So Jesus told a story, but I'm going to tell it just like it would be said to us. So God knows your greatest mistakes, the ones you didn't mean to do, and the ones you did. And God said, I got this. I'll take care of it. I'll take care of the brokenness. I'll take care of the sorrow. I'll take care of all of it. And all you have to do is receive it. And so often, we do that and we go, oh, isn't it great? And what has happened in the church, and what has happened at least in the public view of the church, is we go, I really am so thankful for God's forgiveness for me that I can't wait to see if any of you horrible sinners that are going straight to hell will figure it out. when in turn, and then Jesus in this same line, you know, the metaphorical story he's telling basically points out and goes, and those of you who condemn others, maybe you forgot that it was grace that got you there in the first place. Because I told you to forgive one another so many times that you can't remember the number. And some of us are going, but I'm great at forgiving other people. And I just see God looking us dead in the eye and go, what about you? Why can't you forgive yourself? And we get stuck there. So often we think of sins as these destructive, broken things that break down communities and that break down connection and they break down our hearts. But we forget about the fact that when we pick up the thing that God said to lay down, in many ways it's treating it as though it is more powerful than God is. It's almost a sense of idolatry to say that this thing that I know God forgave me for, I'm going to continue to carry it around and I'll talk about it as a badge of honor. We'll know how much of an impact we've had because God forgave us so much that he did this very specific thing for me that I still feel ashamed about. And so often, we get stuck there. And when we get stuck there too much and too strongly, all of a sudden our view of others changes. Because if God really shouldn't have forgiven us, then we kind of begin to think about maybe God shouldn't have forgiven Cain either. I mean, have you seen his driving? I'm kidding. I actually haven't seen Cain's driving. So I was just picking, yeah, I'm not. But if we anchor in that, like, I wish I were a better person instead of by what Scripture tells us. Scripture and John Wesley specifically points at the fact that when God made humanity, God saw us, saw people and went, well, that's good. Over and over and over, God's like, look at these cool plants, look at those birds, look at these, I think that's a cat, and there's a duck-billed platypus. That's how we know God has a great sense of humor. And then God goes, look how cool this is. And then God formed people and was like, I'm going to make Cain a redhead. And it was good. And if we stay there, then we understand and we get into that space where when we fail, we know that is not the core of who we are. We know that is not who God made us to be. That's a spot where we messed up. Whether we treat it as the original term of the word sin, hamartia in Greek, which is an archery term for you just missed the bullseye. Like you tried really hard, but you didn't quite get there. Or those moments that I've become frustrated with as I've realized that your parenting changes when you get kids who are over the age of 18. And specifically, now you have just as much anxiety and no more control. Does that sound about right for many of you? You worry and you wonder and you hope. And in the end, it all boils down to, I hope they know they're loved enough that if they need something, they can come back. That's the same way God is with us. As Cain talked about that, you know, we laughed about some of the funny ones, you know, I bet $5 he misses again, that's a good sign. Or it's a good sign for there. A good metaphorical sign is the fact that we laugh about it. We laugh about it because humor is many times one of the great healing factors of how we connect with one another. Because when we make mistakes, if we laugh about it instead of brood about it, it a lot of times can take some of that pressure or fear away. And the last little bit that I've come to understand is the more we hide the thing that we need to let go of, whether that is we pretend like we can hide it from God or we pretend like we can hide it from our therapist or a doctor or any other nature or best friends, the harder it is for us to let go of that thing. Because darkness can't handle the light. So when we keep something hidden away, when we keep that broken space of ourself into a spot where we go, that'll never happen again, I will never do something that evil again, and we can't let anyone know, then we don't even process it ourselves. Because our own human understanding of being broken, of not being perfect, is something that we shouldn't anchor our entire self in, as we were talking earlier. Be blessed by knowing that God made you and said, it's good. that if we live it, the fact that we make mistakes, the fact that we can't be perfect, but the fact that in God we have this love that insists that that's okay. Not okay in the, like, do it again, please, folks. But okay as in, that is not the burden we want you to carry around. And there I was using the royal we, Father, Son, Holy Spirit we, okay? So I would invite you, here in a few moments, as we move into communion, to think about a metaphorical moment as you come up about laying down your burden. Letting go of the thing that you are carrying around. And if you're going, I'm not really sure if I feel like it, or I'm not really sure if I can, that's okay. Because so often, the act of forgiveness is one where God's part was done thousands and thousands of years ago, and now it's us living into that new life. It's our reality that as we have experienced these broken things, that we can do different next time. And through the grace and love of God, we can learn those lessons lovingly, carefully, gracefully, and then, so importantly, we can then apply that same message to others. The hard thing is, many times as we're growing and learning, we haven't figured it all out before we become in charge of other people. Whether that's military, whether that's parenting, whether that's working in an office or having friends, we're still making mistakes as we learn through. And so I'm guessing maybe this is why God called us to do it together. Called us to do ministry together, so that when we go, gosh, I really can't seem to figure this stuff out, someone else goes, oh, yeah, me too. In fact, one of the greatest moments of freedom I ever had was when I started talking with other parents in a parenting group when Nathaniel was like 2. So he's like yay tall, and now he's like yay tall. And I was like, sometimes I just don't even like the kid. The other day, he kicked me in the shins and threw something at me. You know, and everyone, you know, you'd say something to like grandma, and she'd go, aw, everybody does that. And I'm like, do you know how heavy those little plastic trucks are when they get chucked at you? And then I met, you know, sitting around the thing with another parent, and they were like, yeah, sometimes I don't like my kid. And I was like, oh, I'm not the only one. Now, to be clear, I love my children. I would jump in front of a bus to save any and every one of their lives. But maybe some of y'all remember, or maybe we're supposed to be intentionally forgetful, that period of no sleep that lasted 7 to 12 years. Right? And if you did like we did, where you kind of stretched out that so you have 30 plus years of parenting, it was longer than short. Well, I wasn't kidding myself. I was exhausted. Some of those things I know I could have done better as you're like sitting there, and if you had a colicky baby, one that, you know, there's no way to solve this, and the whole time you just went, dear God, please make it stop, as you rock side to side until you fell asleep standing. How often is that God holding us? How often is that feeling of I just want it to be different, I want it to be there, is that what we seek? So what I want to invite you is to just receive that embrace of God's love as you come forward. And let it be the focus of your imagination, of your prayer time, as you hear the wonderful song the choir's prepared. I'm like, yeah, there we go. That was your, yeah, no, you're right, Valerie. That was definitely the hint. And so as we move into this time, lay down your burdens. And Wednesday we will go through a practice of another way to do that. So I hope you can join us on Wednesday as we look towards laying them down. But in this space, just let one thing be your focus for this time of prayer and as we move into our time of communion. Thank you.
Some days we are more cruel to ourselves than anyone else ever could be. Teach us the ways of forgiveness for others, but also for ourselves. May we forget grudges and brokenness as quickly as we forget compliments. We offer these gifts and those unseen for your word and will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples, his sisters and brothers, and they shared a ceremony together. It was originally the ceremony of cups, a time of celebration of the Passover, to remember what God had done in and through your family and your people. But as Jesus brought together the bread and the cup, he altered the meaning. He lifted it up as a place and moment of grace. And it moved from a celebration of Passover to a forgiveness of sins, to freedom from sin and death. And so as we gather today, years, centuries, millennia later, God's grace passes through the years. In many ways, it solidifies and strengthens. And others, it releases us to finally rest. But no, it is not just a metaphor. It is not just a symbol. Rather, it is a part of who we are as people of God. So here in a moment when you come forward, lay down your burdens. Because even as Jesus was serving, the person in the spot of honor was the one who would betray him, Judas. The person who would get it all wrong and say, I don't know that guy, was also at the table. So your failures or mistakes, they're not the core to who you are. Because as Jesus looked around the table, he took bread. He gave thanks, Almighty God. Thank you, Lord. And he broke the bread. He gave it to his sisters and brothers, and he said, take, eat, this is my body broken for you. As often as you do this, as often as you eat, remember me. He then took a cup, and he gave thanks to you, Almighty God. Thank you, Lord. And he passed it among his sisters and brothers, and he said, take, eat, take, drink. This is the cup of the new covenant, forgiveness of sins poured out for you and for all. As often as you do this, as often as you drink, remember me. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here and upon these gifts of bread and unfermented wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for this world the body of Christ redeemed by your blood. Make us one with each other, one with you, Lord, one in ministry to the world. Until that day where we feast together with you in your heavenly banquet. All honor and glory and love are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. As a United Methodist Church, we have an open communion table, which means everyone is welcome. It doesn't matter, you don't have to be a member, you don't have to have been in this church your whole life, or even come in before this morning, that you are welcome to receive, because we don't see this as our table as a church, or my table as the pastor, but as God's table of which we are blessed to be able to operate from. God's unending grace meets up with our humanness. So you are welcome as you come forward. We will tear off a piece of bread, and we invite you to receive that with your hands cupped as a symbol that you don't need to pull, you don't need to take, it's given. And then we'll give you a little cup of juice. We invite you to receive that, and at the end of the pews are the spot to put those little cups when you get done with them. But your body will take these bits of flour and oil that is bread, and the juice that is this unfermented wine, and you'll use it And you'll go in and you'll be able to feel a little bit of that sugar come in, a little bit of that, especially if you didn't eat breakfast this morning. But for the reality is your body will absorb and use this, and it truthfully will be used to do that. And so it's the same way of God's grace and God's love. As you receive this, it's there, it's with you, you're set free. The temptation will be to go pick up that rock again the next time things don't go right. So maybe you find your own little space in your home, a little pile for your own little Ebenezer of those reminders of those days when you just needed to set it down again. The ushers will come forward here in just a moment and release you all. So if you have any questions or if you can't come forward, we would appreciate that. Let the ushers know so that we make sure to go to the right spot when we're done. If you guys would.
Thank you.
I used to think that we needed communion to be smooth and well presented and as close to perfect as I could get it as a pastor. And what I've found is that I'd rather it be a little longer if it means me and the other servers are going, okay, did we get every spot where someone might have been missed? Did we miss somebody who maybe said, oh, I don't want to hassle? Because the reality is usually those spots where we're like, I don't need it, is exactly when we need it the most. Or that, I don't want to burden anyone else. But it's not a burden. It's a gift that we get to give, that we get to be a part of. So know that if you ever miss or if we seem to miss you, please don't hesitate to raise your hand. And if by some chance you still feel uncomfortable, let us know at the end of service. We will happily come back up here with you and serve you. Because this is not our table. It's the table of God. And so no amount of slight awkwardness or misstep or oversight do we ever want to come in between God's people and God's blessings. So let that be a center thesis of what we do together, that it's meant to be shared. If you would stand and join in our closing hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Some spots even better. Go with God. Amen.